You know, the next state in the line of primaries is Florida, and after NBC's disappointing debate performance in regarding the Florida primary, I really wanted to get an insider's view. Short of going to Florida myself and starting holding rallies in town squares, I thought, who do we know down there? Who's a friend of the show that we can turn to and say, hey, what is really going on? Because there are some questions that I've raised on this show that I want answers to. So we got that friend. His name is Adrian Wyllie. He is the chairman of the Libertarian Party in Florida. Adrian, welcome back to the show. How are you doing, sir?
Josh, doing great. Great to be here again.
Well, glad to have you. So let's bring the listeners up to speed kind of in something that we brought up last time you were on the show. For those of you who don't know, Adrian gave up his driver's license permit in order to challenge the man and the man's power over us. Adrian, tell us a little bit about that situation, where it started, and briefly any updates or developments in that situation, because that fascinated me.
Sure. It all began when I became aware of how Florida was complying with the Real ID Act as far as issuance of driver's licenses, where you have to present an array of documentation, you have to submit to your face being scanned into a facial recognition database that law enforcement uses, and the documentation that they require. If, for example, law enforcement wanted that same documentation from you, they would have to issue a warrant. However, for the simple privilege of driving, or I would argue perhaps the right to travel, you have to surrender your Fourth Amendment rights. So I wasn't going to do that. I surrendered my driver's license and then challenged law enforcement to pull me over and ticket me. After months of trying and actually calling police departments and sheriff's departments on myself to turn myself in, I was finally able to get a ticket. That went to court. Postponed once because the prosecution wasn't ready for a constitutional argument. Finally, I got my trial. After a week of deliberation, the judge came back and said I did not prove beyond a reasonable doubt that the Florida driver's license laws under Real ID were unconstitutional. So I'm still, quote-unquote, driving without a license, and I'm still challenging the law enforcement to pull me over. At this point, my driver's license has been expired for approaching a year, which is a second-degree misdemeanor punishable by up to 1 year in jail. And I actually had the Pinellas County Sheriff, the county in which I live, on my radio show in studio just last week. And even there, after going through everything with it, he wouldn't arrest me. So there seems to be a real hesitancy to see this issue challenged any further in court. But that's my focus right now. Ironically, I'm actually out there trying to get arrested so that I can have legal standing to challenge Real ID in court.
Well, then that's a fight that has brought you to my attention, because I originally was forwarded the videos that are posted of you on YouTube saying the same thing, that you're trying to get arrested. One was actually in your car and the cop came to the window and wouldn't do anything either. So that fascinated me. And it's people like you who are the real patriots, because patriotism is standing up for the freedoms that we have. And those freedoms aren't realized unless we define them and continually fight for the definitions and borders of those freedoms. It's when we lose that ability that the encroachment starts happening. So thank you so much for your fight. Keep us updated on that.
Well, I'm absolutely not alone in this. I have talked to literally hundreds of people in Florida and outside of Florida that are doing the exact same thing. The only difference between me and them is I've been able to shine a little more light on my particular fight. Others like Kay Beach in Oklahoma is engaged in the same battle, and she's doing a great job up there as well. So there's a lot of people on this fight, a lot of people standing up for what is right.
Well, and that's exactly where it is. I mean, recently I was standing up for the fights or the rights of smokers, even though I don't smoke and I think it's disgusting. I was still standing up for the rights of smokers because I understood if one right is taken away, even if I don't decide to exercise that right, I still lost it. So people who don't think they have a pony in this race are absolutely absurd. They're wrong. When freedom is lost, it's lost for everybody, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely. And your attitude on smoking, for example, is if more Americans had that attitude, I disagree with what you're doing, but I respect and will defend your right to do it or say it, we would all be much freer. And that is really what our founders envisioned for this country when they penned the Constitution.
Well, that is a great segue, because we're going to talk about what our founders intended and where this country is heading next. We're seeing a resurgence of Newt Gingrich, and he's under the impression that he knows exactly what the founders wanted, because he's a historian, and for some reason he'll never let you forget it. But he's telling us exactly what the founders wanted, but everything I'm looking up and finding is kind of the exact opposite. The founders did not want us to lose our citizen rights. They did not want us to have the ability to be reclassified to citizens. What is your take on, in general, broad strokes here, what's your take so far on the GOP field?
Well, first of all, let me say that Newt Gingrich is not only a historian, he's probably the best paid historian in human history. But yeah, it's really, with the exception of Ron Paul, who, of course, is truly a libertarian that happens to be running as a Republican. The GOP lineup is just more big government status, and really the only difference between the current GOP crop and Barack Obama and George W. Bush are slight variations on their rhetoric. As far as how they will govern, it's virtually a continuation of the policies that we've seen for, you know, a couple of decades now.
You know what? And to me, that's heartbreaking, because you're right. It's basically the same package with a different wrapper. And I thought, after the debacle that is Barack Obama, America would be begging for a swing the other way, a swing for freedom, a swing for real American values. And for some reason, that's not what we're getting, which kind of has me looking at you and looking at Florida saying, what's going on? Because one of the things that I've noticed is the attendance at events for Romney and Gingrich is minimal at best. I mean, there's events where Romney actually had to cancel an event because 3 or 4 people have showed up. 10 or 12 people have showed up at Gingrich events. Yet for some reason, they're blowing Paul away in the polls, and something is just not feeling right here.
Well, I think what you've got – well, let me give you an example. Monday night at the GOP debate in Tampa – there was pretty much the standard 10 Romney supporters, 10 Gingrich supporters, and somewhere in the neighborhood between 1 and 2,000 Ron Paul supporters. And I think what that shows is that the people who are awake and active and motivated and really understand what is going on right now in this country, and also what's coming in our near and long-term future, are extremely motivated and extremely mobilized. The ones who really haven't woken up to the fact that we are on the verge of economic collapse, we are on the verge of a police state, we are on the verge of engaging in a permanent warfare state.
Well, Adrian, we're on the verge of a commercial break. Hold on 1 second. We'll be back with Adrian Wyllie right after this. Don't go anywhere, folks. Everybody's familiar with the Founding Fathers. And recently I penned an article called The Restoration Fathers. There are people out there in this country doing what they have to do to restore the freedom that the Founding Fathers fought and died for. One of those men is Adrian Wyllie. He joins us today. Adrian, before the break, you were talking a little bit about how people are starting to wake up to the fact that, you know, we are on the verge of an economic collapse, we're on the verge of a social collapse, we're on the verge of having our freedom stripped from us. Pick up where you left off, sir.
Well, that's basically it. And the question is, how many people will come to that realization? And when they do, what will they be willing to do to restore our constitutional republic, to ensure our economic and personal liberties? And that's the question. And I think that's what part of what you're seeing with the Ron Paul movement is, you know, finally someone is out there putting forward a libertarian message, which is the message of our founding fathers. You know, the message is what is inspiring those people. And I think that's a great thing to see.
So what do you make of the trend then? Because most recent polls have Paul not doing too well in Florida. And I thought after Iowa and after New Hampshire, he was just gaining steam, getting bigger and bigger. What do you believe is the cause of his decline in Florida? Or is it, better question, is it really a decline, or is it some sort of, and I don't mean to sound conspiratorial, but is there some sort of media cover-up of the real support that Ron has in Florida?
Oh, well, I think there's definitely a media suppression of the entire message of individual liberty, of libertarianism across the board. But I think that... Congressman Paul has made a strategic decision in Florida, since it is a winner-take-all state, not to focus his resources here. He's really not planning a lot of campaigning in Florida. He's not spending much money in Florida because, you know, he's targeting states that will, you know, he can get a portion of the delegates. And more of the caucus states and things like that. But the bottom line is this. Unfortunately, the Republican Party will either nominate Mitt Romney or Newt Gingrich to be their presidential candidate. And however, that does bode well for the Libertarian Party. We were pleased to have Gary Johnson, former two-term governor of New Mexico, switch his registration, and he's running for the Libertarian presidential nomination. And so should Ron Paul fail in his bid to win the White House, those people who are awake and do truly believe in liberty will have another candidate in Gary Johnson or whomever the Libertarian Party nominee ends up being.
Well, let's focus on the Libertarian Party as a whole then. There's no doubt that Ron Paul has a loyal following. Even when I dare to say I disagree with him on one issue or something, I get inundated with emails. I mean, he definitely has a loyal following. But do you see that loyal following transferring from just Ron Paul to the Libertarian Party? Or is there still a disconnect like there was in 08 where Ron Paul had a huge base of support, but the growth of the Libertarian Party didn't benefit from that necessarily?
Well, I think one of the things is it's truly about the message. And the message of Ron Paul and the message of the Libertarian Party are almost perfectly aligned. So those who believe in that message, I believe, are going to look to the Libertarian Party. And I think that's going to help move the message ahead and to start chipping away at some of the totalitarian statist laws and policies and procedures that the federal government has enacted over the course of the past several decades and resound us to an economy based on sound money and based on free market principles. And so, you know, it's the Libertarian Party is the home for that message and that fight.
So let's look at the message itself, because there are a lot of people out there who think, oh my goodness, a vote for a third party is just a disastrous vote. I have a response to that I've aired on this show, but I want to give you the opportunity to respond to that. What would you say to somebody who says, yeah, I get it, but if I vote Libertarian, that's really just voting for Obama?
Well, that's based on a flawed premise. And the premise is that there's any significant difference in 2012 between Republicans and Democrats. I mean, let's look at it this way. In the Bush administration, you had wars, you had bailouts, you had crony capitalism, you had the encroachment on our civil liberties in the form of the Patriot Act. Under the Obama administration, you have more war, more bailouts, more encroachments of our civil liberties under the National Defense Authorization Act, under SOPA, and you've got even more crony capitalism. You know, basically, it almost feels like, and I don't want to be conspiratorial here, but it almost feels like the two parties, at least the leadership of the two parties and their marquee candidates, are all controlled by the same interest, whether that be the global bankers or you know, some other cadre. The actual actions that they take is what you have to focus on, and the actions of the last three administrations have been pretty much identical across the board. So that's really what people need to look at. It's not the question of splitting the vote. It's the question of, do you want Coke, Pepsi, or do you want some pure spring water? And the Libertarian Party is that pure spring water. Whereas, you know, the other two parties are just slight variations on the same theme.
Absolutely. Matter of fact, I commonly refer to Barack Obama as Barack Bush because it seems to be Bush 2.0. Everything that won Barack Obama the White House has seemed to be ignored, and it's just a continuation of the same thing. He promised no lobbyists. He would be a lobbyist-free White House. Well, he has 41 lobbyists appointed to his administration. He promised a transparent White House. Well, he's operated under the veil of secrecy more than Bush. So what I find really disturbing is even the progressive friends that I have, they're being lied to by their candidates. My conservative friends are being lied to by their candidates. So wouldn't common sense say, then wait a second, we need a completely refreshing candidate? And like you said, like pure spring water. But it's my impression that even in the presidential election cycle, ever since the debates have been taken away from the League of Women Voters, a third candidate really isn't invited to the table. So how then do we see a Libertarian presidential candidate make any headway?
Well, it's necessary for those people who are awake and who are motivated to get their support behind those candidates. For example, Ron Paul would have never been in the debates if he didn't have the loyal support base that he had, if he didn't have the financial contributions from so many people. So, you know, the truth in politics today is it's not a level playing field. So for liberty-minded candidates, the grassroots have to make it a level playing field by overwhelming support, much more support, volunteer support, than it would take for one of the establishment candidates, and also putting their money where their mouth is and donating to these candidates. And if we do that, we put our libertarian and liberty-minded candidates in a position where they can't be ignored by the media. And that's what happened in the Ron Paul campaign.
Well, exactly. But Ron Paul had the opportunity to kind of enter the race under the GOP banner. And I think what you brought up is huge, that the grassroots has a lot to do with the success in the future of the Libertarian Party. There's this tendency in third parties, whether it's Libertarian, Constitutional, Green, whatever, to have this focus of, man, we are going for 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. That's the place we need to go for. And instead of attacking and trying to get the White House, I believe that they need to shore up those bases, shore up those grassroots efforts. And we need to see libertarians on every school council, every city council, every county board, and just start getting more and more freedom-minded people elected to local offices. All right, before I went headlong right into that break there, I was starting to get to the point of we need to see more people run for local offices. That way, regardless of what puppet happens to be in the White House, there's some security. We know the power of local sheriffs if they're in the right mind. We know the power of local county officials. So we need to get more and more people with freedom in their hearts to run for offices. So Adrian, as a chairman of the Libertarian Party of Florida, you obviously have some insight on this. What can you tell listeners who are thinking, you know what, maybe I would run for a local office? How does that whole process come about? How do they do that?
Well, first thing to do is, if they're libertarian, call me. And you can reach the Libertarian Party of Florida by visiting lpf.org or call 800-FLA-FREE. But basically, you know, running for office, the first step you want to do is contact your local supervisor of elections. Normally, that's on a county level, and find out what the procedure is. Generally, you're going to need to get some petition signed, and depending on how large your district is that you're running for, that will determine how many signatures you need. And the Libertarian Party of Florida has got candidates across the spectrum, from Soil and Water Board to City Council, County Commission, you know, all the way up to U.S. Congress here in Florida. But I think one of the most important positions that liberty-minded individuals can try to win seats in is their state legislature. And the reason is this. It's very important that we use the 10th Amendment of the United States Constitution to try to stop all of these laws and all of these federal agencies' policies and procedures that are outside of Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution. The way that we can do this is by state legislatures effectively nullifying unconstitutional federal law. And so to do that, we need people who truly understand what the Constitution means, what the original intent was, and have a solid grasp of the concept of liberty. And if we get those people into state houses, we can effectively nullify bad laws on the state level.
Well, I would love to see that happen. And you brought up another interesting point that really had me thinking. Very often we hear from listeners who are of some form of religious faith, and they believe by default that the Republican Party is the place for them, even though we've demonstrated time and again how the Republican Party recently is working in their worst interests. What do you say to people who like the idea of the Founding Fathers, who promote the idea of the Constitution, but they still think in order to be a libertarian, they have to be a pot-smoking, almost hippie-level sort of person? Because that's not what I found.
Well, let me put it to you this way. I am a devout Christian, and I don't do drugs. However, I understand that an individual has the freedom to do whatever they want within their personal life, so long as it doesn't infringe upon the rights of another. If my neighbor wants to smoke a joint on his back porch, it affects me in no way, shape, or form. So why should I restrict his freedom to engage in his personal pursuit of happiness, for my personal sense of righteousness? That's not what this country was founded upon. And, you know, part of being a Christian is tolerance and acceptance of others. And for the quote-unquote, you know, moral majority of the current right in this country wants to use the force of government to enforce their personal moral standard. And that's not American.
Well, not only is it not American, it's not effective. I mean, there's a couple of problems I see with it. One, whenever you start creating legislation against some form of activity or behavior, as soon as the other party gets in power, you just empowered them to take your freedom away. So that's strategically stupid. Beyond that, you can't legislate morality. The more you tell a kid they can't do something, the more they're going to want to do it. So if you're going to try to spread a moral message, even if you're going to try to spread drug use as bad, the best way to do it is not through legislation. It's through the freedom to be able to be who you are and live out that example, and that's exactly what Christianity taught.
Yeah, and we didn't learn lessons from history in that regard either. We tend to forget the failure of alcohol prohibition, and that when we outlawed something that a large segment of the population wants to do, that inflicts no harm upon anyone but themselves, when we outlaw that, we introduce the violence, the crime, the cost, and we make normally law-abiding people criminals for pursuing their own path to happiness. And, you know, anytime you prohibit an activity like that that doesn't infringe upon the rights of others, you are creating that black market, and violence and all kinds of unintended consequences always follow. So we should really pay more attention to history and learn from it.
Including collateral damage, because you might say, well, I'm not a drug dealer, so violence isn't going to come to me. But what if that drug deal is going down in your neighborhood, your little son's out playing in the road, something goes down, now the little son gets either shot, ran over, something happens, and it's all because we decided to make the drugs illegal.
Exactly. Not many people are killing each other in the streets for a six-pack of beer.
Very, very true. So, okay, so here we are. Give us some ray of hope that the Libertarian Party is on the right path as we end this hour. Give us some sort of sense that nationwide they're making headway.
Well, I think that the evidence is in the message. The message is gaining acceptance. The word libertarian, something that you would have never heard 5 years ago in any of the mainstream media, is now commonly used to describe candidates. And you even have candidates trying to say that they're libertarian leaning or something to that effect, when most of the time when it's coming from Mitt Romney or Newt Gingrich or someone of that group, it's untrue. But we're winning the war of ideas. We need to translate those victories in the war of ideas into victories at the ballot box. And that's one of the things that I'm focused on here in Florida, and I know the National Party is focused on across the country as well.
Well, Adrian, I thank you for coming on the show today. I think what you're doing is phenomenal. I think that more and more people need to take a look at the Libertarian Party. I know that in my past I was sold out to the GOP just because I was anti-progressive, and that was before I really started understanding strategy and reason and logic. And once I started looking at the Libertarian Party, I started thinking, you know what? For me personally, there's probably no other way I could vote, with the exception of one or two individual candidates. But from a party standpoint, there's no place I could really vote that would be more beneficial to what I believe and the moral enhancements and the freedom I want to make to my country than the Libertarian Party. And from a business standpoint, folks, I have to tell you, as one of the top 100 business trainers on the planet, the only one on that list that hosts a show, if you are a business owner, there is not a more friendly place for you and for your money to go than into the Libertarian Party. I know it sounds like a paid endorsement. It's not. It truly isn't. But if you think about how everybody tells you, well, you can't mix business with politics. Meanwhile, they're mixing their politics with your business. You better wake up, because that only shows detriment, and we're going to cover in the next hour some of the things that Obama said regarding your business. And regardless of if you go right or left, your small business, the mom and dad who are sitting around the table thinking, man, can we really realize this dream? The only way you're going to be able to do that is to get libertarian principles that allow you the freedom to start that business. Like we pointed out in the first segment, Apple today would not have been able to begun under today's regulation. Now it's the largest company in the world, all started by a college dropout who everybody told him he was stupid to start a business. That business that employs tens of thousands of people wouldn't exist in today's world because of the regulations. Everybody thinks, oh, regulations are fine, give more power to the government. Well, I say give more power to more people. Let the people decide what future they want, not a handful of politicians. We hear, you know, we are the 99%, and they're protesting the power of 1%. Well, when you vote government, you're putting the power in 0.0001%. How does that make sense? I tell you, logic, reason, and strategy, it will set you free. We'll be back right after this.